Cerebral palsy is an umbrella term for a group of disorders that affects a person's ability to move. Cerebral palsy is caused by an injury to the brain that usually happens during pregnancy, but sometimes happens shortly after birth. Cerebral palsy affects people in different ways because different parts of the brain can be affected. However, it always has some impact on the person's ability to move, and this is because messages coming from the brain to the muscles is affected. Cerebral palsy is the number one most common physical disability in childhood. Currently, a great deal of research is being done in this field, and currently they have found that there are a number of risk factors that alone or in combination may result in injury to the brain. The most significant of these include prematurity in babies who are born with low birth weight. This often happens with twins and triplets. Other factors include the presence of blood clotting problems for either the mother or the baby, problems with the placenta during pregnancy, and some bacterial and viral infections. Contrary to what was believed for many years, lack of oxygen at birth plays a part for only a very small amount of infants with cerebral palsy. Some of the signs that indicate a baby or child may have cerebral palsy include: they feel floppy when they are picked up and cannot control their head, their muscles are stiff, they display unusual postures with their bodies, their developmental milestones such as rolling, crawling, sitting up, talking are delayed. Cerebral palsy affects people in different ways, and this is largely due to the location of injury in the brain. Therefore, cerebral palsy is described in a number of ways, including the parts of the body affected and the number of limbs affected. Spasticity is present in about 86% of people with cerebral palsy. They have muscles that become stiff and tight, which can make it difficult for someone with spasticity to use their muscles easily. It is difficult for someone with spasticity to turn their muscles on and off when they want to in order to move their arm or leg to do a task or to use their mouth and face muscles to eat and talk. I sat down with Dr. Tanner Thomas and Dr. Ashley Bateman and discussed how physical therapy affects a child living with CP. So Ashley, what methods do you find helpful when working with a child with cerebral palsy?
One of the hardest things when working with children with cerebral palsy is managing their tone, and when you're able to help manage their tone, you're helping to make them be as functional as possible. Some techniques to help do that are NDT handling techniques, including the points of control that they teach when you use that type of handling. Also, PNF patterns can be helpful because they include rotation, which helps to break up their tone. And then also including dissociation in whatever activity you're doing can help them be a little bit more successful with what you're working on. And then also, a lot of the things that we work on depend on what their functional level is, but we work a lot on their posture control. Sometimes they need to work on their head control. And we also work a lot on them moving efficiently, especially if they're ambulatory, work on the efficiency of their gait pattern and things like that.
So how do you incorporate parents into your treatment plan?
It really depends on each family individually, how willing the parents and even the siblings are to participate. I prefer as much participation as they're willing to give. During the session, sometimes they're helpful for helping to motivate the clients, and then also a lot of what we do is incorporate things that they can do at home. A lot of the kids benefit a lot from having a daily stretching program at home so they don't develop contractures. We also help the parents with problem solving for how it's best to position their kids at home, or if they have any equipment needs, we'll help them figure out what equipment would be the most appropriate for their situation, for their family, and help their kids be as functional as possible.
Do you find aquatic therapy to be beneficial for patients with cerebral palsy?
I think aquatic therapy could definitely be beneficial for patients with cerebral palsy, especially if it's in a warm water aquatic environment. We do a lot of therapy in our pool that's between 94 and 96 degrees, which is really beneficial to help patients who have high tone and a lot of muscle tightness. We do a lot of stretching in the pool with them, and it's a great environment to have them relax as much as possible. And then we also use the water because of the buoyancy. It really helps to make the patients as independent as possible. We have some patients who are wheelchair-bound on land for the most part, and they can get in the pool and they can stand. Some of them will even walk with assistance. And a lot of them really just light up and enjoy being in the water. They do a great job with it.
How do you progress a patient's goals when working with them in therapy?
Patients with cerebral palsy have a very wide range of impairments, so all their goals are specialized for each individual client. A lot of the qualifiers for the goals that I'll write for them will be the assist level. So as they improve with the task, they'll need less assistance from me. Sometimes it's beneficial to do smaller increments for your qualifiers so that they can see progress as they go along. And then also for overall progress, the GMFM is a good tool to use. It's specialized for children with cerebral palsy, so it's a standardized test and they can see their progress that way as well.
Thank you for sitting down with us today, Tanner. So can you tell us how cerebral palsy affects the pediatric patients that you work with?
Well, you know, Emily, every pediatric cerebral palsy patient that I work with is a little bit different. You know, case by case variables, we're really trying to work on functionality. It kind of depends on, you know, what level they're at, how severe their cerebral palsy is, how much spasticity they have, where their tone is at. And so it really kind of just depends upon patient to patient what kind of treatment regimen we're going to take them through.
So can you tell us what the ultimate goal of physical therapy would be when working with a patient with cerebral palsy?
Yeah, so overall, when I work with a patient that has cerebral palsy, I am ultimately trying to increase their functional ability with their daily activities and really try to increase their independence so that they feel like they can do things on their own without 100% assistance. Really gearing them, doing things of that nature, we're trying to look at increasing their range of motion, whether it's for reaching or standing, increase their overall core stability, their muscle function in their lower extremities, if that's really affecting them, so that they can either ambulate using no assistive device or possibly using like some loft strand crutches or a kind of a stander if that's, you know, if cerebral palsy is so bad. But really increasing their functional ability, utilizing them as being an independent person and being able to get them independent with their activities is really what we're striving for.
How long will children with cerebral palsy need physical therapy?
You know, that's a great question. Usually, you know, cerebral palsy goes in stages, and so when they are all the way from infants to generally 2 to 3 to 4 years old, at that time most of the education or treatment from a physical therapy standpoint is teaching parents or caregivers to you know, do certain exercises or work on certain stretching or work on certain positioning things. As they progress into the school system, they become more independent with working towards, like we stress, the functional abilities and working towards independence with daily things or ADLs. They kind of go through that as a stage of maybe 5 to 16 to 17, and then on up and through adults. I've had cerebral palsy patients that are adults that we work on decreasing their tone and decreasing their spasticity, or maybe they have a flare up in their spasticity and so we have to work on range of motion or work on strengthening within the core or the lower extremities if they do have a setback for any certain reason. So really, as long as they are gaining and making functional improvements, we'll continue to see those patients from the age of 0 to whenever they feel like they don't need to be functional anymore, which really in the scheme of things never stops. And so as long as they feel like it's appropriate and we feel like they're making functional gains, then we'll continue to see those patients all the way up through adulthood. So